Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Maryam salamun alayha, she is an example for our sisters. For the Muslim women, she is an example. And look how she reacted when a man who was non-mahram to her walked into her room. She said, I seek refuge in Allah. She's saying, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't come near me. And in the books of tafsir, Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala, he brings a statement of a tabi'i who said that the minute Jibreel alayhi salam was told to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the minute he was told that, what happened? Straight away he lost his human form out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He lost his human form and he became the form of an angel.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathira. Amma ba'd, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How's everyone? Okay, yeah? MashaAllah. Brothers and sisters, the topic for my talk, inshaAllah ta'ala, is going to be based around the true story of the birth of Isa alayhi salam. And the reason why I want to narrate to you all and explain to you all and extract benefits from the story of how Isa alayhi salam was actually born is because a lot of us growing up, for example, in the UK and going to school where we have religious studies and we learn about different religions and we learn the general biblical version about how Jesus was born. And many of us don't actually realize that these stories actually get left and implanted inside of our brains. And so even when you start to practice, you still kind of have that kind of version. Like, I want to ask a question. Put your hands up here if you think that Maryam Salamun Alayha was married. No one? Wow, you guys don't know your religion. I'm joking, no, she wasn't married, of course. I was trying to catch you guys out. But for me, for example, for a long time now, I've been practicing for about seven, eight years. And I realized that even when I started practicing, I still had this weird belief that Maryam Salamun Alayha, that she was married. Because we learn about Mary and Joseph, okay? That's how we always heard the story. And I never actually looked into real story about how Isa Alayhi Salam was actually born. So for that reason, I want to clarify for all of us the real story about how Isa Alayhi Salam was actually born and also extract benefits from his life. From the story of how he was born and the lessons pertaining to his mother as well, Maryam Salamun Alayha. And we're going to do this by going through a passage from Surah to Maryam. You know, in the Quran, there's a surah named after Maryam, the mother of Isa Alayhi Salam. And in there, there's about 15 to 20 odd ayat. And I'm just going to explain them and we're going to extract benefits together, inshallah ta'ala. You guys with me? Yeah? Okay. In Surah Maryam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when after he finished talking about Zakariya alayhi salam, who is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is also the cousin of Maryam salamun alayha. He was a prophet and his cousin was Maryam salamun alayha. After talking about his story and the miraculous birth of his son Yahya alayhi salam, who was also a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمْ إِذِ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he then says, talking to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, talking to who? Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to him, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمْ. Mention that which is in the book about Maryam salamun alayha. Mention her story. What? إِذْ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. The word انْتَبَذَتْ here means انْفَرَدَتْ. Meaning that when she isolated herself مِنْ أَهْلِهَا, from her people. Maryam salamun alayha, she separated and she went away. And she isolated herself from her people to where? Makanan Sharqiyya, to a place in the east. Now, just to tell you guys a bit about Maryam Salamun Alayha, she is the daughter of Imran. She is the daughter of Imran, and her lineage goes back to Dawood alayhi salam. So you can see this is a large family, a great lineage of prophets. Dawood alayhi salam, Zakariya alayhi salam, Yahya alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam. It's a whole lineage of prophets. She was the daughter of Imran. Now, her story of when she was actually born was also a miraculous story as well. But in short, to tell you that the wife of Imran, the mother of Maryam, when she was when she wanted to have a child, she made an oath to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if you give me a child, I'm going to make this child of mine serve in the masjid. I'm going to make her serve the worshippers, or him serve the worshippers, whoever they are. So when Maryam salamun alayha was born, she fulfilled this oath and she made her daughter grow up in an environment where she was always in the masjid, where she was growing up in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and she was growing up serving the worshippers and serving those who came to the masjid. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now telling the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam her story narrated to the people. Why? Because then there was one point in her life when إِذِنْ تَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا, when she completely isolated herself from her family and she went to a place within the east. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he carried on, he said فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا. When she went into the masjid and she went into the east side of the masjid, what did she do? فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا. She basically isolated herself and she had a covering from herself and the other worshippers. So she's in the masjid. She's in the far east side of the masjid. And what has she done? She's blocked herself from everybody else. The worshippers are in the masjid, but she wants to isolate herself even more. And subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, there's a very powerful benefit in us secluding ourselves when it comes to worship. This is something that all of us can do. One of the greatest times in a day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, in which we can seclude ourselves and we can isolate ourselves from the world and everybody else, and we can focus on the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is during the night, during the last third of the night, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he comes down to the lowest heavens and he's asking, and he says that who is asking me so I may give them, who is asking for forgiveness so that I may forgive them. And one of the benefits that comes out from this is that when you're alone and you're worshipping and nobody can see you except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is when true sincerity comes out. That's when you can say that you are somewhat sincere in your ibadah. You have a bit of sincerity towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because nobody can see you. Nobody knows what you're doing except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why in a hadith which is narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that on the day of judgment, when there will be no shade except for the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are seven types of people that will gain this shade. And one of them is when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالرَّجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. A person, a man or a woman who would remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they're alone, when they're isolated. فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. And their eyes would flow with tears. Their eyes would flow with tears. Why? Because this person was sincere. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that she basically isolated herself from everybody and she started to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when she was all alone, when she was secluded and she was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did Allah do? Allah said, فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا. We sent our ruh. We sent who? Jibreel alayhi salam. Jibreel, the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends to give wahi to the messengers. The one who came with the Quran to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him to Maryam salamun alayha. But basharan sawiyya, in the form of a man. In the form of a man. He came in the form of a man to Maryam salamun alayha. Now I want you guys to imagine something. I want you guys to imagine Maryam salamun alayha being a righteous saliha, a righteous worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone that's always been brought about with the environment of, you know, of worshipping Allah and being in the masjid. She finds herself secluded in a room and suddenly a man walks inside. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this man is basharun sawiyan. It's a human being that was well proportioned, very well made by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you could imagine what's going through her head, because she's a woman who's chaste and she's righteous, and suddenly a man walks in into a room where she's secluded from everybody else. It's just her and this one man. The minute that she saw this man, Jibreel alayhi salam, walk into the room, what did she say? Allah said, she said, قَالَتْ إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِالرَّحْمَنِ مِنْكَ إِن كُنْتَ تَقِيَّا. She said that verily I seek refuge in Ar-Rahman. I seek refuge from the Most Merciful from you. If you're about to do something harmful to me, if you're about to do anything haram, then I'm saying to you, I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from you. In minka in kunta taqiyya. But if you're a person who's righteous, if you are a person who is fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you're not going to touch me. You're not going to do anything harmful or anything haram to me. Now this is powerful, because here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in another place in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Maryam salamun alayha, she is an example for our sisters, for the Muslim women, she is an example. And look how she reacted when a man who was non-mahram to her walked into her room. She said, I seek refuge in Allah. She's saying, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't come near me. This was the character of Maryam salamun alayha. And in the books of tafsir, Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that the minute he brings a statement of a tabi'i who said that the minute Jibreel alayhi salam was told to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the minute he was told that, what happened? Straight away he lost his human form. Out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he lost his human form and he became the form of an angel. And at that point, he said, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what was his reply? What did Jibreel alayhi salam say? The moment he heard Maryam salamun alayha say that and her getting scared, thinking that Jibreel was going to do something harmful to her, he said, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَسُولُ رَبِّكَ لِأَهَبَ لَكِ غُلَامًا زَكِيًّا. He said, look, I'm just a messenger from your Lord, your Rabb, the one that created you and created me. I'm just his messenger. He just sent me. Why? لِأَهَبَ لَكِ غُلَامًا زَكِيًّا. To tell you and inform you and gift you the news that you are going to have a child who is zakiyan, who is pure. Now at this point, Maryam salamun alayha is confused. She's confused. She's a chaste woman. She's never been married. She's always worshipping Allah. And suddenly Jibreel comes to her saying, I'm just telling you that you are going to have a child, that you're going to have a pure child. And so, out of amazement and confusion, Maryam salamun alayha, she says, قَالَتْ أَنَّ يَكُونُ لِغُلَامِ وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرْ وَلَمْ أَكُ بَغِيَّا. She said, how can it be that I'm going to have a child? It doesn't make sense to me. Now remember, she's not doubting the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because she knows her Rabb. She's been worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for years. She knows of his abilities. But she's confused. She's just amazed. She goes, how can it be the case that I have a child when وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرْ, when I've never been married, I've never had any sort of marriage, nikah, between any man. وَلَمْ أَكُ بَغِيَّا, and I'm not a zaniya. I'm not somebody that's doing haramful things. I'm not going out and having intimacy outside of marriage. I'm not being a person who's a zaniya, someone who's doing zina. So she's confused. And subhanAllah, in reality, if this is the point in which even the Christians became a bit confused, the fact that Maryam salamun alayha, she's never been married, she's never done anything haram, But she's being told that she's going to have a child. She's being told she's going to have a child. And even for the Christians, it didn't make sense. Like, how can it be the case that a woman is going to give birth just like that? There has to have been something. Either there was a man involved, or it's the Son of God. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains to us in the next ayah, but really, if we just understood the abilities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even the Christians wouldn't have fallen into this mistake. Jibreel alayhi salam, he carries on and he says, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ. When Maryam salam alayhi asks, how is that possible? He says, كَذَلِك, just like that. Just like that. All Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to say is be, and it is. Allah said, you're going to have a child, that's it. خَلَاص, انْتَهَى الْأَمْرُ. The matter is finished, you're going to have a child. قَالَ رَبُّكَ. He then says that your Rabb says, telling Maryam salamun alayya, huwa alayya hayyin. This is something which is easy for me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, don't worry. This is something which is easy. Don't question my abilities. This is easy for me to do. This is easy for me. If I created Adam when he was nothing, then for me to bring something out of a woman, it's not difficult. It's not difficult. So Allah said, قَالَ رَبُّكِ هُوَ عَلَيَّ هَيِّنٌ وَلِنَجْعَلَهُ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَرَحْمَةً مِنَّا وَكَانَ أَمَرًا مَقَضِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says that it's easy for him, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to make him, وَلِنَجْعَلَهُ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ. We're going to make this boy who is going to come out of the womb of Maryam salamun alayha, we're going to make him into a sign. A sign for the people, a sign for the disbelievers, and a sign for the believers, for them to ponder upon, for them to think and contemplate. We're going to make it a sign, and we're going to make him wa rahmatan minna, and we're going to make him a mercy from us. Now, brothers and sisters, just to pause here, okay? How is it the case that Isa alayhi salam is a sign? How is it that the birth of Isa alayhi salam is a sign for us? Anybody know? Anybody know? Any ideas? It's okay. I won't. Yes, sir.
This was giving birth out of physical relationship.
Okay. Okay. Good. Good. Anything else? Anybody? Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, in the tafsir of this ayah, he explains why this is a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is the birth of Isa alayhi salam a sign? He says the birth of Isa alayhi salam was his birth was to show the complete ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to creating his creation. He explains why. He says Adam alayhi salam, he was created from nothing, no mother, no father. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought about a human being. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Hawa, salamun alayha. How was she created? From the rib of Adam alayhi salam. So she, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this woman from a male. Created a woman from a male. And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created Isa alayhi salam from just a female. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created something from no mother, no father. He created something from just a man. And then he created something from just a woman. And then he also created the rest of us from a man and a female. And that shows the complete ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in creating his creation. His complete ability that no matter what it is and how it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's able to create his creation. And then he says, وَكَانَ أَمَرًا مَقَضِيًّا. And this is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already decreed. The fact that Allah said, كَذَلِك, it's going to happen. He's already decreed it. You're going to get pregnant. You're going to have this baby inside of your womb. And sorry, I forgot to mention, and how would he be a rahmah for the people? How would Isa alayhi salam be a rahmah for the people? He would be a rahmah because he will guide them to the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Isa alayhi salam, his task, as we're going to see in the next couple of ayat, when he actually talks and he says that his reason that he is a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so he's a rahmah to the people because he will guide them from kufr and shirk to tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and not associating any partners with him. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel and he delivered this message to Maryam salamun alayha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then said, فَحَمَلَتْهُ فَانْتَبَذَتْ بِهِ مَكَانٍ قَصِيًّا. Then Maryam salamun alayha, she conceived Isa alayhi salam, and he was in the womb of Maryam salamun alayha. And so what did she do? She decided to go and isolate herself from her people to a far, far place. She went to a far place away from where all the people are. And the reason why she's left is because she knows she's going to have a miraculous birth. But she knows that the people around her know that she's not married. So when they see her pregnant, what are they going to do? They're going to accuse her. They're going to make accusations. And they're going to say to her that you're a woman that just committed zina. They're going to make accusations. And because she didn't want to hear any of that, and she was afraid of all of that, she said, you know what? Let me just go to a far place and deal with my pregnancy there and away from all these people. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he carried on, he said, فَأَجَاءَهَا الْمَخَاضُ إِلَىٰ جِذِعِ النَّخْلَةِ قَالَتْ يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبَلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that during this time, when she's gone to a far place and she's isolated herself from her family, what's happening? He said that, فَأَجَاءَهَا الْمَخَاضُ إِلَىٰ جِذِعٍ. What happened is that the pains of childbirth, the labor pains, the pains that a mother goes through when she's in labor, when she's contracting, and she's going through the pain of childbirth, that pain started to come to Maryam Salamun Alayha. And it led her to a palm tree. It led her to a palm tree where she went to lean on it. And I don't know if any of you guys have seen a woman ever give birth. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that. But wallahi, it's something. It's shay'un akhar. It's literally something else. Wallahi, it is literally something else. The pain that mothers go through in order to deliver this one child, wallahi, it is something else. And that alone, wallahi, I tell all of you guys, every single one of you who are not married, every single one of you are not married, the day you get married, the day your wife becomes pregnant, the day your wife gives birth, and you see her going through labor pains, wallahi, that will be the day that you'll truly respect your own mother. Because it's not a joke. Wallahi, it's not a joke. You'll see it with your own eyes. You've seen the pain that they have to go through just to deliver the child. Forget about the months before when she's carrying the baby in the stomach, and then the years to come later when she has to nurture and raise a child. Just the pains in and within itself is sufficient for you to realize the true maqam, the true station, and the true honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to parents, especially mothers. So due to the pain, she's lying at the palm tree. And she says, قَالَتْ يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتْتُ قَبَلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًّا. She says, woe to me. If only I had died before this even occurred. Before what occurred? Before I became pregnant. If only I died before that, and I was something which was forgotten, and I was something which was never ever known to the people, and I was something which never even existed. She goes, I wish that was my situation. Why? Because the pains are so bad. And then at that point when she's panicking, and the pain of labor, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَنَادَاهَا مِن تَحْتِهَا أَلَّا تَحْزَنِي قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيًّا. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that something called, there was a call from beneath her that says, أَلَّا تَحْزَنِي, don't worry, don't be sad, don't grieve. قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيًّا. Don't worry, don't be sad, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Rabb, He's placed beneath you a river which you can drink from. Now, the Mufassirun, they dispute whether the caller who called, whether it was Jibreel alayhi salam, or whether it was Isa alayhi salam, from the stomach of his mother. Regardless of that, a caller called, and said to Maryam Salamun alayha, don't worry and don't be sad. You're panicking, you're going through this pain. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed water from you underneath you, a river which you can drink from. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَهُزِّي إِلَيْكَ بِجِذِعِ النَّخْلَةِ تُسَاقِطَ عَلَيْكِ رُطَبًا جَنِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then told her, that date palm tree, the date palm tree that you have, shake the branch of it, shake it, so that the dates, they can fall upon you and that you can eat. So you can eat them because of all the pain that you've gone through and all the energy that you've lost from doing this childbirth. Eat those dates so it can give you energy again. Fakuli, eat. Washrabi, wakarri aina, and drink the water that you have and give contentment to yourself. فَإِمَّا تَرَيِّنَّ مِنَ الْبَشَرِ أَحَدًا فَقُولِي إِنِّي نَظَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ سَوْمًا فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says to her, now that you've given birth, now that the child is born, now that Isa alayhi salam has been born, now if you see anybody and you come into contact with anybody, they're going to question you, they're going to accuse you, they're going to ask you questions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if they ask you questions, فَقُولِي, say, إني نظرت للرحمن. I took an oath to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Ar-Rahman, a sawman, that I'm going to fast. فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيَّ. And today, I'm not going to speak to anybody. The fasting in the Sharia at the time of Maryam Salamun alayha wasn't the fasting like we have. Our fasting is that we don't eat, we don't drink, and we stay away from intimacy with our spouses. As for at the time of Maryam Salamun alayha, when they were fasting, their fasting was from talking. They wouldn't talk. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to her, be quiet, just don't talk. Anyone's going to ask you questions, they're going to make accusations, they're going to point fingers, just don't talk. Just don't talk. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُهُ. Then when Maryam salamun alayha, after being from the far place, after from giving birth to Isa alayhi salam, she came back with the child. فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُهُ. She came back to her people carrying the baby. قَالُوا, they said, يَا مَرْيَمْ, O Maryam, لَكَدَ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيَّا. You have done a terrible thing. You have done a terrible thing carrying this child. What have you done? Have you done something haram? They're questioning her. They said, يَا أُخْتَ هَارُونَ. They said, O sister of Harun, مَا كَانَ أَبُوكِ امْرَأَ سَوْءٍ وَمَا كَانَتْ أُمُّكِ بَغِيَّةٍ. They said, O sister of Harun, your father, he wasn't an evil person. He was a good man. And your mother, she wasn't somebody that committed zina. She wasn't someone that used to do haram things. So they're saying that, look, your mother was good. Your father was good. What happened to you? You've never been married and now you're carrying a child. So they're making all these accusations. Imagine the state of Maryam Salamun alayha. She's worried. She's confused. She doesn't know what to do. All she knows is that Allah told her, don't speak. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. When they started asking all these questions, they're pointing fingers at her. What did she do? فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. She just pointed at the baby. She literally just pointed at the baby. She pointed at Isa alayhi salam. They said, قَالُوا, كيف نكلم من كان في المهد صبيا. How do you expect us to speak to a baby that's in a cradle? Like, they're asking, like, are you okay? Like, this is a baby. I can't speak to a baby. It's just been born. Why are you pointing at him and telling me to speak to the baby for? At that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He defended Maryam Salamun alayha on the tongue of Isa alayhi salam. Isa alayhi salam, being in the cradle, being a baby that was just born, he now speaks in honor to defend his mother, Maryam salamun alayha. And Allah said, Qala, he said, Inni abadullah. Verily, I am the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Atani al kitaba wa ja'alani nabiyya. Allah has given me the kitab wa ja'alani nabiyya. And brothers and sisters, wallahi, this ayah in and within itself is powerful enough. The first thing that Isa alayhi salam spoke, and it was an honor to defend his mother, what was it? He said, Inni abdullah. He said, I am the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here you can see that the Christians got it completely wrong. Isa alayhi salam spoke, and he told the people, I'm not a god. I'm not the son of God. I am Abdullah. I am the slave of Allah. And here we have people today who have taken Isa alayhi salam as a God. They've taken him above the status which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. They took him above that. And wallahi, this is something which is common today, because a lot of Muslims, even today, if you talk about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you say he's an abd, you say he's a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they get angry and they say, no, don't say that. He's a messenger of Allah. And we say, na'am, he is the messenger of Allah, but he's also the abd of Allah. He's also the slave of Allah. And in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him with the name abd. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he honored the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the name abd. For example, in Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he started the surah and he said, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ الْفُرْقَانَ عَلَىٰ عَبِدِهِ لِيَكُونَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ نَذِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, blessed be the one who sent the Furqan, meaning the Quran, عَلَىٰ عَبِدِهِ لِيَكُونَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ نَذِيرًا, so that he may be for mankind a warner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he is sending revelation upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no time in which the Prophet is being more honored than the time when revelation is coming to him, when the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are coming unto him, and Allah called him abd. Allah called him abd. And here Isa alayhi salam, he speaks about himself and introducing himself as being the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Time finished. Yeah, طيب. There was more ayah that I wanted to explain to get to the end of Isa alayhi salam's speech, but time does not permit me. But inshallah ta'ala, you guys can go out of your way and read Surah Maryam. Just read the English as well. Wallahi, yani, it's yakfi, it will suffice you. But for us to know that Isa alayhi salam, who he truly was, and who his mother was, and who his lineage goes back to, and the fact that he introduced himself as being the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not being the son of God or a god or anything like that. Anything which I said which was incorrect is from me and shaitan, and Allah and his messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Hey guys, I really hope that you benefited from that video. Before you go, I want to ask you a really important question. Have you guys ever thought about studying Islam and seeking knowledge? If not, then I want you to reflect upon this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet said that seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every single Muslim. Of course, that doesn't mean you have to be a scholar, but you have to know the basics in order for you to be the best possible slave and worshipper of Allah that you can possibly be. So we decided to provide a solution for this. You see, many people want to study, but they don't have the means or the resources to do so. So we set up an online institute called the Knowledge College, where you can study Islam from the comfort of your own home. So if you want more information on the Knowledge College and you'd like to sign up, go to the link below, check out the website, and hopefully we see you on the other side. Assalamu alaikum.